Shalom and welcome to Jerusalem Studio. Israel, surrounded by regional chaos and a new ally in Washington, is once again trying to bring Iran's ongoing violations pertaining to its nuclear aspirations, ballistic missile testings, and support of proxy militias to light, urging the international community to act. During today's program, we will try to identify the situation based on recent events, and to do so, I'm joined here in the studio by Dr. Elisheva Machlis, an expert on Middle Eastern and Iranian studies from the Hebrew University at Jerusalem. Shalom. I'd like also to welcome our TV7 analyst, Mr. Amir Oren, and Dr. Eldad Pardo, who is the research director at Impact SE and a lecturer at, on Iran, also at the Hebrew University at Jerusalem. Shalom. Mr. Oren, give us a little bit of an understanding. How much of a significance is this reemerging statements and moves and strategies being brought forward by Israel on the matter? And are we expected to see a new pattern that was also the same way a few years back?
Israel and Iran have been engaged in a conflict ever since the late 1970s, when Khomeini came back to Tehran and the Shah was toppled, and this conflict has undergone several stages. Right now, it's mostly war by proxy, but it's war nevertheless. There are many actions which are being taken behind the lines, in both meanings of the way. Usually the media doesn't find about them unless it's really noisy, it's really kinetic, but the Israeli Defense Forces and intelligence agencies have been undertaking a systematic series of actions. And of course, the Iranian forces, mostly the Revolutionary Guards Quds Force and their allies, Hezbollah and others, are also active on the Syrian front. This is deadly serious, but there was a funny footnote to it all recently when Jews all over the world celebrated the festival of Purim, and there was an exchange between Prime Minister Netanyahu and Foreign Minister Jawad Zarif regarding the historical context of the Persian-Jewish relationship. Mm.
Dr. Machlis, how do you perceive the situation?
Well, first of all, we have to understand that there are changes occurring in Iran. We have to understand that there isn't one voice coming out of Iran. There are different factions. And currently, we have, on one hand, the more conservative factions that are involved in Revolutionary Guards. But on the other hand, we have also some pragmatic forces represented by the current president. I think one important element that we have to wait and see is the coming elections to the presidency. And I think it would be wise to watch the situation and see how that evolves, to see if the current president, who is a pragmatist, a centrist, if he receives mandate to continue his more pragmatic, centrist course, or if we see the conservatives being strengthened. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Pardo?
If we take it to follow up from the Iranian point of view, I would say that while Rouhani is more pragmatic, in reality, what we see since the negotiations started during the time of Ahmadinejad in 2011, but we see that Iran is getting more and more intransigent. You see more and more Iranian forces and Iranian militias all over the Middle East. You see ballistic missiles. And Rouhani was also, when he negotiated with the Europeans, he said, you know, in the 2003, 2005, he said, okay, we will put on hold, you know, enrichment, but develop other aspects of the nuclear program. And this is exactly the same strategy today. They put on hold a certain aspect of the program while they're boosting the other stuff. I would also would like to comment on Zarif's interesting point. Mm. And this is, it is true that Cyrus the Great allowed the rebuilding of the Jewish temple. But on the other hand, since the Shiites came to power in Iran in 1501, Iran was the worst area in the Muslim world for Jews. And during World War II, it is true that some Iranian diplomats saved Jews, and also some Iranian people helped the Jews. But this happened after they were conquered by the British and the Soviets. And indeed, before that, they were very close to the Nazis, and they started to divide the Jewish property among themselves. So history, that's a short lesson in history, indeed.
Mr. Oren, there is no question, there is no doubt with regard to the growing escalation between Israel and Iran in recent weeks or in recent months, if you really try to identify the point where Israel has been emboldened to a certain extent, considering its failure to do the various aspirations it had with regard to the nuclear agreement and so on. It started with the inauguration of Donald Trump, where Prime Minister Netanyahu has declared that he will now seek, together with the administration in Washington, to rewrite or to entirely cancel this agreement. Give us a little bit of an understanding. Where does that stand?
It's almost 2 years since Netanyahu went to Washington to speak to a joint session of Congress in an effort to foil the deal or the American participation in the deal, because obviously there are many other partners to the deal. And sometimes in Washington, they tend to forget it, that it's not an American agreement with Iran, but a multi-party agreement. Of course, the United States is a very important part of it. So this happened in March of 2015. And for the last 2 years, Netanyahu has been on the defensive regarding the nuclear deal, but he was emboldened, as you said, by the election of Donald Trump. However, we've seen in the 2 months since Trump has been in office that some of his declarations were probably pronounced for effect in order to set a marker from which he can withdraw in order to get some deal. So we don't see any sign yet of the Trump administration working on Capitol Hill or elsewhere in order to change, not to say abrogate, the deal. But we do see some of the key people in the administration, such as the Defense Secretary Mattis, and recently the commanding general of the Central Command, General Votel, speaking about Iran's efforts to expand its influence and work through proxies or directly in Iraq, in Syria, and elsewhere. And Netanyahu has been trying to focus on this point, both in his call to President Trump, as well as in his visit to Moscow.
Dr. Machlis, does this mean that Netanyahu has practically failed in trying to rebring this JCPOA, the Joint Plan of Action pertaining to this nuclear agreement? He, of course, visited Trump. They both talked about the nuclear agreement. Trump voiced that there will be coordination with Israel on the matter. But when he visited later also the United Kingdom, Theresa May pretty much rejected any attempt to reestablish new or fresh sanctions against the Islamic Republic. Does it mean that Netanyahu's new approach, as we hear from Mr. Oren, pertaining to Iranian involvement on a regional aspect, is more viable in Israel's position?
Okay, first of all, we have to remember that there are several sanctions, and there's still sanctions that are continuing, which are sanctions related to terrorism, which go back to the early years of the Republic. So actually, the sanctions that we're talking about, the lifting, is only related to the nuclear operations. So Netanyahu can be assured that the other sanctions related to terrorism are still in place. Mm-hmm. In addition, I think we have to remember that the Islamic Republic is, on one hand, a revolutionary system, revolutionary regime, but it's also a republican regime. So we have really the two aspects of the Islamic Republic. And perhaps it will be also wise from the Israeli perspective to address these two parts of the regime differently. We have the international community that can work with agreements that can perhaps also be beneficial to Israel, but you also have the military aspect, the revolutionary aspects that perhaps has to be dealt differently.
Dr. Pardo?
I think if I look at the Israeli policy, at least since the beginning of the Arab Spring 2011, Israel's tried to stay out of the Arab world, but now I think Israel cannot forever stay out, because we are going we are moving sooner or later into a new Sykes-Picot, a new division of power in the Middle East. And until now, we've seen two main revolutionary forces. As Elisheva said, one of them was the Iranian Shiite network across the region, and the other was the ISIS Sunni revolutionary. Now we see that somehow ISIS is a little bit checked, and you know, everybody hopes that, that this will be the end of it, at least for the Middle East. But the Iranian network is still there. They also have some setbacks, particularly the involvement of Russia in Syria and the involvement of the United States in Iraq. Both of them are a problem for Iran. But still, Israel must take care of our interests on the nuclear issue, on the Middle East picture at large. And of course, international terrorism. Iran has a fantastic network of international terrorism everywhere that is just ready to go. And so this is also something to be taken care of.
On this specific topic, I'd like actually to touch base on a new declaration by an Iraqi Shiite militia, which entered the fighting in Syria since 2013 to join forces with the army of President Bashar Assad in order to try and keep him in power, maintain the Shiite Muslim power within Syria. Mr. Oren, do you believe that their just recent declaration that they will start to establish a new brigade on the Golan Heights, on the Golan region itself, adjacent to the border with Israel, to try and remove all forces, not Shiite Muslim or not loyal to the Assad regime, is that something that threatens Israel directly, or is it more against the other organizations that are currently operating in that area?
As you say, this is a new development, but there is a long-held basis to them, because Israel has been facing Syria ever since it was established, and Syria was one of the countries which attacked it. And Iraq is, of course, a neighbor and sometimes competitor with Syria. And on the other side of Iraq, you had Iran as the enemy of Iraq, and therefore an ally of Syria on the one hand, especially after the Islamic Revolution, and also of Israel semi-clandestinely. Now, after Iraq under Saddam Hussein has been effectively decimated in 1991, and at the same time the Soviet Union disintegrated, the Iranian need for Israel to counterbalance Iraq or other Arab factors dwindled. There was no real interest, no matter who the regime is, what sort of regime you have in Tehran, there was some interest in an alliance with Israel, for instance, in arms sales during the Iran-Iraq war, even after Khomeini took power. But right now, Iran doesn't need Israel, so it can play in the playground of Syria via those Iraqi Shiite militias at will. It doesn't mean that it wants Israel to be provoked and hit directly back at those militias, because obviously Israel will not sit silently by and watch any hostile force entrenched on its northern border.
Just last week, Dr. Machlis, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu went to Moscow to visit President Vladimir Putin, during which they did raise Israel's concerns in front of the Russian president pertaining to Iran's ongoing efforts to really put a military foothold within Syria, including on the border with Israel. Do you believe that if all the various urges, the various threats that Israel is leveling towards the various forces operating in Syria that are, of course, allies of Iran, will Israel take an active role in that war?
What I could say is that I think it's a question of priorities. And as of now, it seems to me that both Iran and Hezbollah are busy internally with developments in both Syria and Iraq, as Amir Oren explained. So I think the priority as of now for Iran and for other forces that are operating within the region is more internally, and they're not, at this stage at least, interested too much in confronting Israel. So I think we could make a parallel also to Israel's choice.
Dr. Pardo?
Yes, what I see, and we've seen it in the past in several reincarnations in the history of Israel. Israel tries to play the role of the babysitter or the go-between, the United North America, Europe, Russia, and the Arab world, and to bring all of them together to some kind of coordination, even Turkey, in order to try to bring some moderation to the Middle Eastern region. I would not be surprised if at a certain point Israel will also try to become a go-between the Sunnis and the Shiites. We have to remember that Elisheva is an expert on that, that the majority of the Shiites across the Middle East are much more moderate, and they are ruled by dictatorships in southern Lebanon, in Iran itself. We know, at least in Iraq, that most of the Shiites follow Ali Sistani, who is very old, but still very much staunch pro-democracy. And their voices now in Iraq, people are really sorry for what they did to the Jews. They understand that they brought the country into this kind of intolerance and intransigence and hate of the other. And they would like to go back to the 30s and 40s, when to the 20s and 30s, when the country was much more liberal. Mm-hmm. So I would see, if I analyze right the Israel's policy, it tries to bring much more dialogue and coordination in the region and the world, and also to support all the moderates across the region, either Sunnis or Shiites.
Mr. Oren?
Ever since the Israeli Defense Forces withdrew from Lebanon some 17 years ago, and Hezbollah got to the border, there has been an Iranian military outpost adjacent to Israel. But this outpost up to now has been consisted of ground troops and rockets or missiles. What the Iranians want to add to it, and this was made public when Netanyahu went to see Putin, was a naval base. They want to have some naval vessels along the Syrian coast. We don't know whether the Russians would allow it, because they, the Russians, want to have a base of their own. They do have it already. They want to keep it with Tartus or Latakia. But the Iranians want to add a naval dimension to their presence in the region. This would be a first for them. Up to now, they have been only in the Persian Gulf or Indian Ocean, mostly, of course, centered on the Straits of Hormuz. If they have a foothold on the Mediterranean, it will bring the conflict to a new level, and Israel has been warning the Russians and others to prevent it.
Dr. Machlis?
I think we have to also remember that Hezbollah and Iran are very, very close allies. But as of now, the biggest threat is actually the jihadist forces and how they're fighting Assad's regime. We have to also remember that Syria is in a strategic alliance with Iran since the early days of the revolution. So I think the first priority of Iran as of now is to maintain the survival of this regime.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Pardo?
When we talk about Iran, and we have to remember the two elements in the political culture that usually are not discussed too much. One of them is the imperial tradition, and the second one is the racist tradition, the being Aryans and having the large empire. This is extremely and powerfully present in the inner discourse, and the fact that they build intercontinental missiles and they're sending their ships and they build tanks and build airplanes and all, and try to spread their influence all the way to the Mediterranean and through Yemen, take hold of the holy places of Islam and thus controlling the entire Islamic world and putting pressure. They are very, very similar to what we see in Turkey, with differences. You know, we see Erdogan pushing himself into Europe. The Iranians do it in a different way, but the goal is the same. They want to take hold of the entire Islamic world and continue. Of course, we are talking here not about the entire Iranian people, but like 10, 15 percent of the population that control everything, and they proved themselves to be extremely tenacious and even wise in conducting the business.
Even though we do still hear reports about Iranian vessels provoking U.S. Navy vessels in the Strait of Hormuz, as well as British vessels and other navies of Western countries, the notice that the United States put the Iranian regime on, how much of a significance did that have, as the Iranians seem to just carry on with what they used to do before that notice?
The only casualty of this notice has been retired General Flynn, who made the announcement and a few days later was fired, not because of it, but he is no longer there. And what the Iranians have been doing tactically can be described as defending offensively. They have been not only projecting power, but also trying to project the aura of power in order to deter, in order to gain points domestically. And you see that many of these incidents, which you refer to regarding naval activities, are by the Revolutionary Guards Navy element, not by the Navy of the Iranian Armed Forces, because they are more seasoned. They are more experienced. They know that incidents at sea can end by vessels being sent to the bottom of the sea. They don't want to provoke the Americans. Up to now, it has been a war of words. Yes, there were some skirmishes, some vessels sailing too close for comfort. But nevertheless, if you look back, you can see that the same pattern held a few years ago before Trump, regardless of Trump. We have yet to see any real engagement, whether verbal or actual, by the two regimes.
Dr. Machlis.
If I could just add to the point here, we have to remember that Iran is interested in both being an Islamic leader of the region, but also a very strong nationalist force. And that goes back to the period prior to this revolution. So as a result, Iran would like to establish itself as a very strong regional player, both from an Islamic and a nationalist point of view. But on the other hand, Iran is also a very rational player. And as a result, it always treads a very fine line. It's not interested in direct confrontation, but always testing the waters. Now, regarding the U.S., we have to remember that part of the revolutionary slogans and the ideology is very anti-Western, very anti-American. So I think particularly now, it's also important for them to establish the fact that on one hand, there's negotiation, there was a nuclear deal, but there's still a very strong anti-Western agenda.
Dr. Pardo?
Yes, definitely. Iran is they are very pragmatic, but their goal in general is bringing back the Mahdi. They have apocalyptic dreams. They envisage a big war.
Let me ask you this, actually.
All of this is, so the fact that you
are... Dr. Pardo, when we're talking specifically about the Iranian aspirations and their anti-Western sentiments, we still see this regime in Tehran receiving financial support from Western countries. They just completed a deal with French company Boeing, where you see more and more airplanes reaching the Iranian airfields under Iranian sponsorship, which was invested following the nuclear agreement with Iran that the world powers have reached with it. But more and more we see that Iran is interested in more business, whether it's the Germans, whether it is in Belgium, so on and so forth. How does it, on one hand, seek to divest itself from Western culture, but at the same time it seeks to invest in Western business?
Well, so far, this is the paradox here with these sanctions. The regime, since day one, as we heard, had these sanctions. And they want the sanctions. Because without the sanctions, they don't have the emergency situation. Without the emergency situation, they cannot rule because it's a dictatorship. It has some kind of... there's no parliament in Iran. There is consultative majlis, consultative council, which means that the dictator asks the people what they think, and then he decides. So it's 100% Iranian. It's 100. The source of power comes from God directly, and the leader gets his information directly through meditations from God. He doesn't need to listen to the people. He's just kind of a procedure.
And this is something the people in Iran accept?
First of all, there is a very long tradition in Iran. Also, all the kings and the Shah, it goes to pre-Islamic times. The idea of divine light going down to the leader. Iranians themselves, they are extremely talented in sciences. And you know, Europeans go there. They say they are not Arabs. They are like us, but they are not like us, because the Iranians themselves, when they write about themselves, they admit that Arabs are much more democratic than Iran itself. They have no democratic culture. Mm-hmm. If you look at their potential, they could be like one of the leading countries in the world.
But Dr. Machlis, would you like to comment on that?
Yes. The Islamic Republic perceives itself as a very progressive republic. And as a result, it's interested in developing science, nuclear, and the economy as well. Because there's an understanding that if the regime isn't stable and the economy is not running in course, then they won't be able to develop. And this is the basis of the current president Rouhani's support. It's the economic basis. And as a result, there's an understanding that Iran has to open up, at least from the economic perspective, to foreign business. But this doesn't mean that culturally it has to be pro-Western.
Well, we're almost running out of time, so I'd like to give each and every one of you the opportunity to have a closing statement. Mr. Oren, we'll start with you.
What we see through culture, through media, through sports, and what have you, other aspects of life, gives the impression that there is a sizable segment of Iranian society which wants to end hostility, and nevertheless, they want to be an empire. They don't want to be overextended. There is some need for communication channels, even between Israel and Iran, in order to use this window of almost 10 years, 10 or 15 years, regarding the nuclear deal, in order to take the heat out of the conflict.
Dr. Pardo?
I think Israel is wisely doing in bringing back the issue to the agenda. I would think that Israel should enhance its dialogue with people of the region, both Sunnis and Shiites, and definitely there is not enough communication in Persian towards Iran, and this also has to be there. But on the other hand, we have to remember that if there is no strong pressure on Iran, things may get out of control.
Dr. Machlis?
We see moderate forces among the middle class, among the youth, but I think the change is very slow in Iran, very gradual change, and we still have the conservative forces that are extremely strong. So I think Israel should work on both fronts towards the international community, trying to maybe enhance the moderate forces, but also be very strong against the more conservatives and radical forces.
This is unfortunately all the time that we have for today, so I'd like to thank you very much, Dr. Machlis, for coming here, Mr. Amir Oren, and Dr. Eldad Pardo, and I'd like also to thank our viewers. We will see you next time. TV7 Israel's mission is to give you, our viewers, truthful information, which in effect will give you a chance to really understand what is happening in Israel and its region. If you are blessed by our programs and believe our mission to be important, we urge you to support us and become a voice for Israel. You can support us by going to our website at tv7israelnews.com. This program was made possible through your donations.